So my experience is as a foot soldier, with some years spent slogging away, trying to get parliamentarians, governments, and civil society organizations to somehow work together and make some actual progress in tackling the global environmental crisis, because there is more than one, even if climate is the one that we are talking about today. But the question that this panel is addressing is not new. Democracies have a long history of struggling to address wicked problems, particularly those where the reward is thought to be far in the future, and that require difficult, politically unpopular changes across society, and changes that face well-organized, highly motivated, and extremely wealthy opposition. Yet, I believe that we are finally on the verge of a tipping point. The evidence is increasingly clear of the irreparable damage that we are doing to our planet. And no longer this is a problem just for future generations. This is hurting us now. And people are increasingly involved, investing, consuming, protesting, and critically also voting for change. That political parties across the UK, at least, are vying to be the most environmentally friendly is a sign. And that is something that would have been unthinkable just 10 years ago. So yes, it's a positive sign that most democratic countries have started their zero carbon transitions, except for Australia, which is ranked 60 out of 60 countries in the most recent climate change performance index. And yes, it's true that many democracies have made substantial climate pledges and they are updated NDCs these past few days at COP26. While autocracies like China and Russia have been sitting on the sidelines. It is also true that there is unprecedented demand for people across the world for more ambitious climate action, and climate strikes and protests appear to be increasing each year. But it is true that the signs are a bit mixed. So the number of environmental defenders assassinated every year, for example, continues to grow, including in democratic countries like Brazil or the Philippines. There is also very understandable cynicism that all the promises made at COP26 are going to go unmet. Once that this high-flying ambition meets the cold, hard political reality at home.
So there are three recent trends in how the public see climate change and how they engage with it that I'd like to pick out in my 7 minutes this evening. The first of those is that climate concern is now mainstream among the public in democracies. So at Ipsos Mori, we're very fortunate to have a lot of long-term and frequent data about how the public see climate change, among other issues. And here in the UK, when we look at what the public see as the most important issues facing the country, the trend we see is that environment and climate change have moved up the ranking over the past few years to be seen as one of the top five issues the country is facing, alongside the pandemic, the economy, the NHS, and Brexit. So we are seeing really high awareness across the board of climate change as an issue, and also a real sense of urgency that we should be doing something about it. So over half of us in the UK, for example, feel that actually the government should be trying to achieve net zero sooner than the 2050 target. So there is that real sense of concern and urgency among the public. And another interesting trend to note is that when we were looking at this a few years ago, it seemed to be a very young, metropolitan, left-wing view, but that has now become much more mainstream. We don't see as many differences when it comes to the level of climate concern by age, gender, even party support as we did, although things like region of the UK and socioeconomic status still do make a big difference. So you sometimes hear the lazy assumption that it's young people who are most concerned about climate change. That's no longer the case. This is a mainstream concern for the public. Second point, though, is that when we look at the scale of the transition that is required, then from a democratic standpoint, I think there are some signs that should concern us all. So yes, people are concerned about the issue of climate change, but they have overall fairly low levels of knowledge about what either they personally or what governments and corporations should do about it. And there are also fairly low levels of awareness about the extent of the transformation that's going to be needed in society if democracies are going to reach net zero.
There is an enormous amount to be said on behalf of certain kinds of democracies and certain kinds of participation that are about the intrinsic value of having citizens be the authors of their own laws and the authors of their own states. That is a completely different question from whether or not you think democracy is specially good at being a problem-solving tool, particularly for problems like climate change. So nothing that I've said counts against the idea that citizens should write their collective fate as well as their individual fate, and that this is a value that we should promote. But I also want to say that for me, there's something a little off about the framing of many of these discussions around climate change, because I think they fail to take two points that are, for me, really central. The first is that with respect to climate change, we all are living in failed states. This is not a question of here we are floating down the river, life is as hunky-dory as we used to say in 1950s America, and suddenly we have a problem on the horizon, and the question is, how do we solve this problem? That is not the state that we're in. Every country in the world, regardless of its system of governance, has failed to respond adequately to the challenge of climate change. We need to understand that, and bromides are not on the path of the solution, whatever those bromides are about. Secondly, I also think there tends to be a cop-centric view of the challenge of climate change, that if only we could knock the heads of world leaders together, we could get them to put the right words down on paper, that sort of all of our problems would at least be under control, or at least we could sleep well at night knowing that the daddies and mommies of the world, you know, were actually running the ship. The real action on climate change is global. It's everywhere. It's in Belize, it's in Indonesia, every bit as much as it's in Glasgow. I would argue even more than in Glasgow.